Thank you for attending our talk, Natural Disasters Elicit Spontaneous Multimodal Iconicity in Onomatopoeia and Gestures, Earthquake Narratives from Nepal and New Zealand. This presentation was assembled by Lauren Gawne and Casey Ford, both at La Trobe University, and by Kristine Hildebrandt at SIU Edwardsville. We also wish to begin and end our presentation by thanking the narrators and also the other members of our teams who collaborated with us in the documentation of earthquake narratives on our project, which was largely funded by the National Science Foundation. I'm Kristine Hildebrandt, and I'll be doing the talking for the first few slides before the others take over. Here I lay out the organization of our presentation. We first define onomatopoeia. We then turn to the context of the 2015 earthquakes in Nepal that led to our documentation work. We then pivot to some specific observations about the form and function of onomatopoeia in that Nepal corpus. Then Lauren will take over with connections between onomatopoeia and gesture, and we'll conclude the presentation. For those who want to learn more about our methods of documentation in Nepal, we provide a link to the 2019 paper. We want to start out with a working definition of onomatopoeia as part of the way that people may encode meaningful information about what they are talking about in the way that they talk about it. In this way, we are really honing in specifically on onomatopoeia in this study, but we acknowledge that it is part of a larger field of study in iconicity, and it's connected also to other types of studies on expressives. While speakers can readily employ manipulations of existing lexical items in this larger area, we're particularly interested in the use of otherwise non-lexical forms used to represent some of the more dramatic events in the narratives. Here is an example of onomatopoeic form from a speaker of Shuba, one of the languages in our corpus. Shortly after the catastrophic earthquakes in 2015, a team of 16 research partners collaborated to record the lived experiences of the survivors across a grouping of Tibeto-Burman languages, detailed on the next slide. The team asked survivors and responders to recount their reactions at the time of the events and also to describe what they know about earthquakes in a more general way based on their lifelong experiences and belief systems. These accounts were collected in the form of free narrative-type discourses and also semi-structured interviews between mother tongue speakers. We are working here with a subset of texts, 35 recordings representing 7 Tibeto-Burman languages of Nepal. These recordings were made between 3 and 12 months after the earthquakes and, as noted before, include conversations between local participants. The Shuba recordings were managed by Lauren Gawne's project, and the others were organized by the NSF-funded team. We include references to other publications that analyze other forms and functions that emerge from the corpora more generally. We note that in our examination of patterns, some languages have more published descriptions from which to base our observations than do others, but we hope this corpus is part of a feedback loop that can enable deeper description of these languages in the future. This study examines 82 tokens of the onomatopoeia across the discourses collected in a single corpus. Our numbers are lower than in our original abstract, and that is because our operational definition narrowed after the initial set was collected. Additionally, we have at least temporarily discarded some tokens because of insufficient glossing, and we hope to get more detail on those instances later to determine whether or not we can include them. Similarly to what Guillaume Jacques noted in his study of idiophones in Chifu conversational discourse, we see quite a bit of variation in the actual employment of onomatopoeia across individuals. Some speakers never use them. Many speakers use them only occasionally and at very specific points in their narration, and at least one speaker makes very frequent use of them. I first want to turn to observations on phonological patterns in these forms. Tibeto-Burman languages are known for their mostly monosyllabic prosodic word structure, where canonical syllables have strong restrictions on onset clusters and coda consonants, and where tone and accompanying laryngeal states may or may not be present. However, we observe that this canonical pattern can be readily expanded for onomatopoeic uses. In particular, in our corpus, we see some impressive total or partial reduplication with resulting word-like forms approaching four or five syllables, far outside of what is generally considered the canonical word size in these languages. And I'll illustrate this on the next two slides. We also see more expansive use of consonants that are otherwise more restricted in distribution or in frequency in the lexicon, for example, a proliferation of retroflexes. In addition, we also notice some instances of vowel alternations in a kind of alliterative structure, which symbolizes uncontrolled movement of a general kind. This slide shows examples of the variation in phonological shape, with duplication of CVC where the final C is nasal, or CVC where the final C is plosive, also replication in breathy voice and replication in aspiration, replication of initial clusters, and even duplication of two-syllable structures. Beneath this table, we inventory the total number of syllable patterns that we have observed, which exceeds 35 different types. As Lauren will discuss in later slides, to our knowledge, these onomatopoeic forms are mainly not derived from existing lexical items in these languages, but are rather conjured spontaneously for the function of sound symbolism, often with accompanying gesture. We still need to more deeply investigate conditions under which full or partial reduplication may vary, but it's interesting to note here that full reduplication is more frequent, and in most partial reduplication instances, we observe the substitution of one consonant in the reduplicant for another in initial position. For example, we see the substitution of a flap or even an initial stop or sibilant consonant, or we see that there is a stop place of articulation substitution.
Thank you, Kristine, for that introduction to our project and the phonology of onomatopoeia as we've observed it in these recordings. I will be taking over from this point. My name is Lauren Gawne, and I'm going to look at the syntax and semantics and then the multimodal implications of onomatopoeia in this corpus. With regards to the syntax, the most common structure we see by far is the use of onomatopoeia with some kind of do verb. I've given an example here from Tloa and one from Nubri, but we see it across all the languages. And this accords with Matisoff's observations of similar forms in Lahu, where a kind of dummy do form is used to frame the onomatopoeia. There are some other common structures that occur, such as the use of some kind of verb of saying, the use of some kind of copula, or unsurprisingly for this corpus, some kind of shake verb. We also see onomatopoeia used in non-sentential constructions as well, so it has a great deal of flexibility within the narrative, as others have observed, when you have this kind of non-canonical word class that can be used in this illustrative way. I've divided the discussion of the semantics into two groups. I want to talk firstly about the semantics of shaking that we see, unsurprising as a frequent semantic type in this corpus again. What is more interesting, though, I think, is if you look across the languages in these narratives, you see that some forms, like the gutu gutu for the shaking of the house, will appear only in one narrative and seem relatively more spontaneous than a form like ling ling, which is used for earth shaking, house shaking, is used across at least four of the languages in the corpus and seems to exist in a larger cultural area. We see a range of different ways of representing different kinds of shaking. Some of them are more codified than others. Other semantic domains that we see include things breaking and falling, the sound of an engine. We also have some human movements such as trembling or heart beating with the kind of adrenaline of the stress of the earthquake. There are some more abstract human feelings, so rather than being a concrete representation of a physical action, we also see some onomatopoeia representation of confusion or unsettledness or fearfulness. And unlike in more kind of canonical collections of onomatopoeia, which I'll talk about briefly in a moment, there's very little animal-based onomatopoeia in these narratives. I only have two tokens. I've just put them here, representing the shaking of an animal's ear and then its head, which is a common metaphor for talking about earthquakes occurring across this region, where you have a mythical creature within the earth that shakes and causes the earthquake to occur. So not as much of that kind of animal onomatopoeia that we think of often as the kind of canonically more lexified type. Convenient to our purposes, both Shuba and Loa have extensive community-compiled dictionaries. They were made with SIL and a local NGO affiliate in Nepal under the rapid words methodology, where many individuals from the community come together to work on a semantic domain-based approach to collecting lexical items. The Loa dictionary has 94 items labeled as onomatopoeia. The Shuba dictionary has 30. And we see relatively very little overlap between what kind of came to the surface in elicitation-based prompts and then what strategies people actually use for onomatopoeia. And again, as is well discussed within the literature on onomatopoeia and idiophones and iconicity in general, these forms do tend to be less canonical and less standardized. The only one we see is this Shuba form, garang garung, meaning rumbling. Sometimes it's the lexical form for thunder in these languages, and we find this across the area. So this is a kind of a nice quantified illustration of the importance of ensuring in a documentation project you're collecting spontaneous narratives as well as those standard lexical elicitation processes. As Kristine discussed at the top, onomatopoeia is just one iconic strategy people have for situating themselves in an event. Another iconic way to represent narratives, and one that's really relevant to my research interest, is the use of gesture. So how we use our body in correlation with the spoken or signed utterance to represent the physical event that occurred. This is a kind of preliminary piece of work, but I wanted to make sure that we demonstrated that we're not just thinking of onomatopoeia as an isolated phenomenon, but thinking about it in terms of the larger narrative and the larger communicative practice of individuals. So just to briefly introduce an additional comparative data set that we used to look at the difference in how people gestured and referred to earthquake events between the Nepal corpora that we collected and a corpus of narratives from the 2010 Christchurch earthquakes. This is a seismic corpus from New Zealand, a really beautifully represented open access corpus. It's available online. I used 16 recordings from the larger corpus that we've drawn on today and 16 English speakers from New Zealand, and focused on how they described the first seismic event that they describe in their narrative. We know from the really great work of Dingamansa and Akita in Japan, looking at Japanese earthquake narratives, that you tend to get strongly expressive onomatopoeia likely to occur with gestures in these really action-heavy events like earthquakes. One of the really interesting things to note, particularly for this paper, is that none of the English speakers used onomatopoeic strategies in the 16 examples. So while we see a lot of onomatopoeia in Nepal, and I think well over half of the Nepali speakers, while describing this specific event that I analysed, used some kind of onomatopoeia, it was a less salient descriptive strategy for English speakers, which is just a nice indication of the potential for cross-cultural variation in onomatopoeic frequency. Another variation between the speakers in Nepal and the speakers in New Zealand is that in Nepal, the trajectory of the gesture was a lateral trajectory, side to side, whereas the New Zealand speakers overwhelmingly used a vertical gesture shape. So I have examples here. Dawa Dolma has that frequently used ling 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 sound to represent the shaking boom. And then we see Annie from New Zealand, who uses a much smaller vertical trajectory there. As best we can tell from our primary analysis, the variation in gesture seems to represent the interaction of the earthquake and local building types. New Zealand houses built mostly of wooden frames. The way they impact is absorbed by these houses is much more vertical, whereas in Nepal, you have stone houses built right onto the earth and you get a much more lateral shaking experience. And so not only do we get the variation in the types of onomatopoeia people are using, but we also get the variation in the types of gestures that they're using. which seems to indicate some cross-cultural variation, but also potentially some cross-experience variation, where people who share dramatic multisensory events tend to communicate the experience using iconic strategies that are more similar to each other, which is why you get these similarities in Nepal and these different similarities in New Zealand. Today, we have taken you through some of the features of the onomatopoeic strategies that our speakers and storytellers in Nepal use to describe earthquake events. These strategies have structural and semantic commonalities across speakers and across languages. These aren't always captured by traditional lexicographic or documentation methods. I think it's sufficiently well established that drawing on spontaneous narrative is a rich way to understand the full variation in human language use. We'll be using this primary data-driven description to build a more detailed and fleshed out analysis of the onomatopoeia, and also look at it as part of the larger iconic representation of narrative. We've touched on that by looking at the co-occurring gestures today. We didn't necessarily set out to look at onomatopoeia when we initially collected these stories. All the project work was driven by creating a oral history record, and now we have the opportunity to continue to build a nuanced understanding of these events. We have a publication that we've written on the reported speech structures people use. The team are working on a paper looking at the local understanding of the causes of earthquakes. But what is most important to us is that we're creating an accessible archive of materials with transcriptions of metadata so that we can continue to drive linguistic analysis, cultural analysis, and help us better understand these events as they occurred. We have a list of references here you can come back to if you're interested in anything we've cited, links to the archives for the seven languages we've talked about today, and we look forward to talking with you in the question session. Thank you.